Waffle UI is a medium difficulty web challenge from Hack the Box that involves attacking a custom application where we can order some waffles or ice cream. For this challenge, we are given the application source code, a Docker environment to reproduce locally the same server infrastructure, and a remote server to connect to get the flag. As always, we can start building the Docker environment while taking a look at the application. Here, we can't do much. We can only order some waffles or some ice cream and nothing more. By looking at the request sent to the server, we can observe that it sends a JSON object containing our order, and it also uses a serialized PHP SSID to identify the user. Usually, serialized data can be very dangerous, especially when they can be arbitrarily modified, like in this case. Let's keep it in mind for later. By the way, I already did a video about the basic concepts of serialization and deserialization. So, if you are new to this, I really suggest you to take a look at that video first to better understand the following challenge. Since the application doesn't offer many features, let's take a look at the code to better understand the internals of the program while we wait for the Docker to finish. The build docker.sh script, the Docker file, and the config folder do not contain very useful information for this challenge. They just provide a bunch of configurations to correctly set up the environment, but we can skip them for the moment. The web application code, instead, is located under the /challenge folder. index.php is the application entry point. Here, we can see that some PHP controllers and models are included. Then, an XML file is read and processed by the XML parser model class, and then the PHP SSID is checked and eventually set up. Then, a bunch of routes is defined from the router class contained inside router.php, one of which is the one performing the user order through the order controller class. Taking a closer look at that class, we can see that it reads the PHP SSID, and then it tries to unserialize it. Between the two operations, however, the backend verifies which methods are available for every object using a very specific regex. If the regex matches some PHP magic methods, so the one starting with a double underscore, then the application returns an error. Otherwise, it sets up the user object and then returns the message that pops out when submitting the order. The order controller class also checks if the debug environment variable is set, and if it's true, it writes some logs. Okay, up to here the application seems very secure. However, we still need to take a look at the two classes used to instantiate the two objects. User model looks very basic. It just contains the username property. XML parser model, on the other hand, appears very peculiar. The class implements two magic methods. Construct, which is invoked every time an object is created and simply assigns the passed data to the object property. And wakeup, which is invoked every time a script tries to call an object as a function or every time an unserialized function is invoked on that object. This method verifies that the content of the data properties is a safe XML, then it converts the XML string into an object using simple XML load string, and finally it creates an environment variable for every key contained inside the XML. Alright, it's speculation time. By looking through the code, I noticed different things that perhaps can be exploited or used during an exploitation chain. index.php and router.php both contain some include that maybe can be used to exploit a path traversal or a local file inclusion. The order controller class writes some logs that maybe can be used in combination with the LFI. The same class also uses the PHP complex syntax that in some cases can lead to RCE, and it unserializes user controllable data, which can potentially allow the injection of PHP object and alter the program logic. There are so many possibilities. But which is the correct one? Or even worse, is one of these paths the right one? In this challenge, users can only control four data: the ordered food, the table number, the serialized cookie, and the XML file parsed by the application. Searching where the ordered food is used didn't highlight dangerous uses, so we can exclude this option. The same can be done with the table number, which even never appears within the code. The remaining option is to exploit the PHP SSID cookie and try to inject some kind of PHP object. I've wrote a simple script that serializes two custom objects, one using the user model class and one using the XML parser model. As expected, providing the first serialized object to the backend, nothing happened. Instead, providing an XML parser model object caused the server to fail, telling us that we provided an object having an unsafe method. How do we move forward? Well, because we have both a custom environment and the application source code, we can temporarily disable those protections to understand how the server would behave without them. We can also add some debugging information here and there to better understand what the server is processing and how those regex work. Let's rebuild the Docker environment and see what we can do and what information we can obtain now that filters are no longer a problem. Submitting again the request that previously went in error, we can see that now it works. We don't get a username back because the serialized object does not contain a user, but the fact that the server response indicates that this request was successful. We know that we can unserialize arbitrary data, but the application does not contain dungeon functions that can allow code execution. What we can do now? Because the only interesting class we can use is the XML parser model, let's start analyzing every single line of code. The regex is constructed in a way that matches every possible XML external entity attack containing the system or public keyword. This means that code execution can't be achieved without bypassing this regex. But why did developers implement this rule? Probably they were worried that XXC injection could be exploited. But why there is such control? Where is the flow? After some research, I discovered that simple XML load string is called using a dangerous parameter that enables entity substitution, facilitating XML external entity attacks. XXC attacks exploit the possibility to include within the XML some external resources. The XML document type definition, also known as DTD, can be fully self-contained within the document itself, but can also be loaded from elsewhere using XML external entities. Because the simple XML load string supports entity substitution, we can force the server to contact us, providing a way to exfiltrate arbitrary files. Awesome! Now it all makes sense. We potentially have a deserialization vulnerability that may allow us to unserialize an XML parser model object vulnerable to XXC. Let's try it out. I created a basic XML containing an XML entity that overrides the debug key to any value. In this way, we can verify if it works using the creation of the log file in TMP as a reference. If the file is created, it means that the entity works. Otherwise, it means that the debug value is not overwritten and therefore the code block is not executed. First, we have to ensure that the log file does not exist. Then, we can use the same PHP script used before to generate our cookie. And finally, we can send it to the server. Here we go. The file was created, meaning that we can use entities and external entities in our exploit chain. Unfortunately, the data contained in our XML is not reflected anywhere in the application. This means that we cannot exfiltrate data by reading them through the app, but we must necessarily use OAST techniques. OAST stands for Out-of-Band Application Security Testing, meaning that we have to use external servers to see otherwise invisible vulnerabilities. Using external entities, we can force the application to perform an HTTP request to our server, sending us any data we extracted using the other entities. To test it, we can use the same payload as before, this time implementing an external entity called Blind to try to contact our server. Perfect! We receive an HTTP request. We can use external entities to send and retrieve data. To concatenate multiple entities inside the document type definition, we can use parameter entities, special XML entities that can only be referenced elsewhere within the DTD. They use the percentage character before their name, but they can be referenced like a traditional XML entity. We can try to read the flag using the flag parameter entity in the combination with the PHP schema. Then we can combine it with a traditional external entity inside another parameter entity. I'm using PHP colon double slash instead of file colon double slash because it allows me to encode the file's content in base64 since any special characters may give some problems. Unfortunately, using just a simple DTD containing the full payload didn't work. That's because, as mentioned in the official documentation, in the internal DTD subset, parameter entity references must not occur within markup declarations. However, it is also said, this does not apply to references that occur in external parameter entities or to external subset. So, we can place the malicious payload inside an external DTD and then download it using a simple parameter entity. Let's try it out. I created an external DTD named test.dtd containing the malicious payload and I reference it inside the .env XML file. In this way, the application should download the external file, replace the various entity with the corresponding values, and finally send to my server a request containing the value of the flag, encoded in Base64. It works! Using external parameter entities, we can successfully exfiltrate data and retrieve local files. Now, we have to find a way to bypass those regexes, preventing us to inject malicious PHP objects and malicious XMLs. First, we can try to bypass the XML filter, but not before you subscribe to my channel and leave me a deserialized like. Seriously, it would be appreciated so much, so thanks in advance. Using a site like Regex101, we can analyze the regex in detail and see if it matches our payload. Unfortunately, it does, but as we saw from the PortSwigger site and also from this other post, we can use entities inside XML strings to try to find a workaround for restricted XXC. To bypass this regex, so we can implement another XML parameter entity, this time simply containing our encoded payload. As we can see, the regex does not match anymore, while the exploit is still working. Great, we are almost done. Now we have to find a way to bypass the safe object regex and inject malicious PHP objects. This took me a while, but after some research, I found this useful write-up from Megadodo publication talking about a remote code execution in Composer. Although the target is different than ours, going through the article, I found a really interesting thing. The author had to bypass the same regex we are facing. The write-up shows three different bypasses. The first one uses a plus sign to bypass the regex. However, starting from PHP 7.2, it doesn't work anymore. For this challenge, we are using PHP 7, so we can scrap this first option. The second one exploits a parser differential between the regex and the PHP serialized object, tricking the regex into thinking that semicolon O colon 10 is the class name of the object and so hiding hello world from the regex. Finally, the third one uses a pretty unknown and deprecated feature that allows the creation of custom serialized objects starting with C colon instead of the classic syntax. Traditional PHP basic types variables follow standard rules. However, by implementing the serializable interface, it is possible to serialize data using the C colon format. This was the part that took me the most, but after several days of testing, I was finally able to craft a working payload that exploited the third technique and bypassed the regex. I started using the same code provided in the write-up, but it didn't work as expected and it returned a different serialized object that didn't use either the C colon format or the semicolon colon trick to bypass the regex, but instead was a pretty standard serialized object. I still don't know why, so if you have any idea, please let me know in the comment section below. However, after some research, I found some discrepancies between the article and the statements written in the official documentation. So I decided to move on, assuming that maybe the SPL double linked list class wasn't the same used by the author. Because the official PHP documentation says that inside serialized object created using the serializable interface, there could be any payload between brackets, I decided to create a script that simply injects my serialized object within the example provided in the write-up. The PHP code declares an XML parser model class equal to the application's one. Then it creates an object reading our previous XML payload, serializes it, calculates the corresponding length, and finally places it inside the container shown on GitHub. Testing the result on Regex 101, we can see that this time the regex does not match anymore. If the exploit works, we are ready to get the final flag. Let's host again our malicious DTD. Let's fire up a web server on port 10099 to exfiltrate data, and then we can send the malicious serialized PHP SSID. We made it. We bypassed the two regexes and we can now exfiltrate any data from the server. HDB. Who lit the encodings out? After having completed the challenge, thanks to SAC X7832, I discovered that also the second bypass technique was working and could be used as well to evade the regex checking for malicious PHP objects. The following script creates two different objects, one using the bypass mentioned before and one using the standard way. Providing both objects to the regex, we can notice that the regex is misconfigured and match any sequence starting with semicolon, even if it is contained inside a string. Semicolon is used inside serialized objects to separate different properties, but the regex applied does not consider that strings may contain those characters, matching the wrong element and thus opening another parsed differential opportunity. This was my solution for Waffle Y order. Did you already know about parser differential vulnerabilities, or have you ever exploited one of them? Let me know it in the comment section below. Thanks to everyone who stayed with me up to here. I hope you enjoyed the video and that you find it helpful. If so, please consider leaving me a like and subscribe to the channel so that we can meet again in the coming videos. Having said that, see you next time. Ciao.